Hello everyone, this is Bob Norton and this is session number 2 on the growth and scaling workshop program we're running, which will have 12 sessions, and this is about team. So let's get into it. A little bit of background on me, just because you may not have seen one of the other sessions first. I've been a serial entrepreneur for about 30 years. I started as a technologist, and I've had 4 exits, founded 6 companies, still have 2 of those companies going now, and returned over $1 billion in net profits to investors at more than a 25 times ROI. Those companies are even today doing tens of billions of sales. Of course, they continue to grow afterwards. There is a typo there. That's not 17 million in equity creation per year. It's actually 71 million in average equity creation. That 14 years over $1 billion. I've also created the CEO Bootcamp, which started in 2004, and I've graduated thousands of CEOs and entrepreneurs from that in 40 different countries now, and created AirTight Management, which I believe is by far the world's best leadership operating system for growth companies. It's modular, and we'll talk a little bit more about that because some of those things and components are about scaling and growth. I've taken 2 companies from raw startup with no sales to over $100 million in sales, and that's 1 in 6,300 companies statistically. And let's see, before that I was a technologist, VP of Engineering, Chief Technical Officer for the first 8 years of my career. I was a founder at Thomson First Call, as well as Thomson Reuters, which back then was called Thomson Financial Services. I've published close to 400 videos now, 200 articles, worked in 40 different industries, and authored about 6 different books, including one with the father of leadership, Dr. Warren Beenis, who passed away a few years back. Also a big serial hobbyist. I have a 42-foot racing yacht that I've raced in the past, big on scuba diving and other things. That's my sailboat, and it's a great microcosm of life and business, running a sailboat with a small crew. You learn a lot from that too. So let's talk about scaling and scaling versus growth. Most everyone knows that near 80% of new startups will fail. What they don't know is that only 1 in 400 of those companies will ever reach 10 million in sales. And so the odds statistically of building a profitable company are much higher than building a $10 million company. And when you raise that bar to $100 million, only 1 in 6,300 companies will ever reach the $100 million in sales level. And so you've got to ask, why is that? Why is it so rare? And that's what we're going to talk about in this series. All the many moving parts, hundreds of different things that are required to get a company to massive size. And it's a marathon, not a sprint, and it requires hundreds of skills over time. So statistically, and this is just the raw math, it's 1,260 times harder to get a company to 100 million than it is to build a profitable startup. And most people don't understand how high that mountain is and what a big challenge it is. And they confuse smarts or intellect with experience. And experience is what you're going to need on your team for many different areas. And that's what we're going to talk about today. How your team has to be the puzzle you piece together to create a scalable company. So our goal in scaling is to get companies to at least 25% compound annual growth rate, and ideally 50 to 100%. That requires some things that we're going to talk about shortly. Most companies will never be able to do that. But we can make any company do that. I'm famous for saying that any company can be a $1 billion company, because a company is just a legal entity you put products and services into, right? So if you're willing to expand the products you have and build better products and more products and take those products to other markets, you can reach 100 million and a billion with any legal entity you create. AirTight is for companies with $1 to $30 million in annual sales, and it's 100% agnostic what we do because it's about people. It's about strategy. It's not about the domain experience, which is often greatly overestimated, and we'll talk more about that later in hiring. So let's define scaling. You know, we talk about scaling as at least 25% compound growth, preferably 50 to 100%. And so growth looks like that, and scaling looks like this. And of course, when you compound that over time, you're talking about massive differences in the size. So the normal growth for a small company might be 5 to 15%. Of course, right now we have 10% inflation. And so if you were growing 10%, you really wouldn't be growing at all net inflation. But that's sort of normal survival rates. Those, you know, 5, 10, 15, you know, sometimes even 20% growth is pretty small growth, because after inflation it might only be 10%. But scaling is much more rapid growth, and it requires a different mode of operation. It will get exponential because each passing year you're multiplying a bigger number by that 50% growth or that 100% growth. You know, in our last year at Thompson, we added $50 million in revenue, which was 100% growth. No, I take that back. It was $35 million in revenue, which was about 50 or 60% growth in our fifth year. But each year, the absolute numbers get bigger, and you have to adjust for that and think a lot about that so that you don't have brain drain and dilution of institutional knowledge, and you have longer time horizons for planning and many other things. But, you know, I'm going to show you the exact numbers and show you why this is sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy of success if you have that kind of growth and can create it. So, you know, if you have a choice of being at a scaling company or a growing company, you're really going to want to be at that scaling company, and any smart employee or founder or investor is going to want to be there too. Now, the foundational material, or the raw materials that is necessary to be a scalable company, is that you're going to have to be in the top right quadrant of this graph. At the CEO boot camp, I say the most important word for a company and for a CEO to think about is the differentiation. The differentiation is what creates higher margins, lower sales cost, more effective marketing and messaging, etc. You've got to have differentiation. A company that is a commodity is not a scalable company. You would have to pour enormous amounts of capital into it, and that capital doesn't get returns because you can't have the profit margins in a commodity company. So hence, you're not going to attract the capital that would be required to scale a commodity company. The second column here is a competitive company. And so that's one that's matching or doing as well as everyone else. It may have some scalability. It might be able to grow at 20 or 25% or something like that. Obviously, you know, if you're geographically isolated and you're, you know, the only supplier of oranges, you know, you're not a pure commodity in that country or whatever, right? So there are exceptions and there are many factors. There might be 5 or 10 different factors that make up these things. But overall, you want to step back and say, how much differentiation do you have? And how much protectability do you have? So to be a scalable company, you really have to be in column number 3 here of at least distinct. And that's going to allow you to grow at 50 to 100%. And if you're a breakthrough company, you know, we're talking the unicorns, the Facebooks, the Dropboxes, the hugely successful companies that grow, you know, more than 100% because they're unique in the marketplace. And they're the first there with the only option in a market. And so they dominate their market. And sometimes once they reach the dominant position, they have sustainable competitive advantage created by that dominance. So to be a scalable company, you have to be in that area. We can take companies that are competitive and move them right and upwards in time by changing the product mix and adding more protectability. There are about 17 ways we do that. And adding differentiation, which means innovation, right? Peter Drucker, the father of management, is famous for saying that a company has two jobs, innovation and marketing. And those are the hardest jobs because they require the most creativity and the most intellect. And you have to do a lot of trial and error to innovate. Risk is the flip side of the innovation coin, and there's always a certain amount of trial and error going on. But to be a scalable company, you need a foundation that's starting with some of that differentiation and protectability. Doesn't matter how much money you raise, if you don't have differentiation and protectability, you do not have a scalable company. So here's what the math of this looks like. And what you'll see here is if you started with $2 million on that column C, right, and you grew at 10%, 25%, going to 100, here are the multiples on what the business would be here. 5 years later, it would be 16.4 times bigger, 32 times bigger with 100% growth rate, right? And this 2 million, because these are the absolute revenue figures that you have. So where would you want to invest if you were an investor? Well, of course, many venture capitalists will tell you they're going to look for those home runs that have that kind of growth. And so to be scalable is to attract capital. And that creates a self-fulfilling prophecy of success, because if you have capital, you can attract better people. If you have that kind of upside in the stock, you can attract and keep better people. So you really want to design your business. And this is a choice. This is not circumstances and rolling the dice. This is your strategy. This is how big your problem is. This is what, you know, how much innovation are you creating inside that business to get that kind of growth. So Jim Collins says that greatness is not a function of circumstances, the same thing that I just said in a different way. It's about discipline. It's about conscious choice. It's about driving innovation and what the Japanese termed Kaizen, which is constant little innovation. So you can grow as fast as you choose. If you have that differentiation and protectability over time, and you install the right team planning and systems. And that's what we're going to talk about today, with this session being a focus on the management team, or the managers and the C-level people and founders. We use this five-level or stage model of company development. I'm not going to review this. It's here for reference. You can take a snapshot. You should know where you are on this today. Typically, early revenue, you know, is that the ranges of revenue can vary greatly depending on the industry and the margins, etc. But typically, you know, we work with AirTight management and start to scale companies only once they reach about $1 million in annual sales. To be an established company, you have to check off 20 or 30 different things to be able to move to establish and have the foundation to build a scalable company on. And there's no shortcuts to this. This is what you will need to do, and the skill sets that you will need. You'll see that the oval in the bottom left here is the design and business research to make your plan. Who's your market? What's your innovation? What's your technology? What's your protectability? Recruiting your initial team. Then you build the product in that middle oval, and then you launch the product. You will have to do these, all of them, every one without exception, to build a scalable company. If not, you have not built the foundation, and you're going to have to go back and redo it later. So, you know, you might launch a first product that gives you a little cash flow and maybe funds something else, but you've got to do all of these things. And this, by the way, this is, every one of these icons is a course we have at entrepreneurshipu.com. And collectively, all of this is our Master of Business Acceleration program. And lots of it goes into the CEO Bootcamp, which has a lot of overlap of here. So there's about 40 courses here, and you're going to have to get them from your team. That's why we're talking about them right now. They don't have to be full-time people. They don't have to be you know, committed long term for every one of these skills, but we're going to talk about the ones where that is necessary. So we like to say that either you're going to do this at startup phase, or you're going to have to redo it all later. And you know, there's no excuse for not doing your homework, because this is the foundation that you can build a scalable company on. So team, it's like real estate. In real estate, it's location, right? Most venture capital investors, rightly so, will use team as a proxy, because a good team is going to fix any other problem. So hiring is fuzzy logic, it's intuition, it's feelings. It's not an exact science, and to do it 80% success rate is pretty darn good. But we're going to talk about the few people, the founders, that need to be committed long term, because them leaving could be very disruptive to the company. There are certain things that you need to filter on and eliminate. Personality. You know, you've got to screen out sociopaths. You know, 5% of the population is either a sociopath or a psychopath. That's a fact. If you're in a room with 20 people, there's probably, you know, one of them in there with you. You cannot hire those people. They will destroy your company. So we have a course on that, and hiring and screening people. Go to YouTube and search on Southwest Airlines video AirTight Management. It will tell you about the Southwest Airlines hiring process and their screening process. Very surprising and entertaining. You know, I think it's only a 4-minute video or something like that. I don't want to take the time today, but take a look at that. So the most important personality traits, and it amazes me that recruiters always get this wrong. And the reason they always get this wrong is because they've never been CEOs. They've rarely been hiring managers with a lot of experience. And they tend to want to hire someone from the same industry. And that matters less and less the more senior you are in the organization, because the domain and industry experience is a function of what the individual contributors do. And the other things, like the art of management, the art of leadership, the art of strategy, these things take 5, 10, and 20 years to get to become a master at. And so they're so much important, as are these raw characteristics or ingredients for the best employees. You've got to have curiosity and a desire to constantly learn, what some call being self-actualized. You've got to hire people that are driven to succeed and willing to do the hard work. You've got to hire people with critical thinking skills, logic, that are data-driven and can take their emotion out. Jack Welch, in most of his books, the CEO of a GE for many, many years, he said seeing the most important thing that he looked for in executives is seeing what was there and not what they wanted to see. Well, whether he knew it or not, he was talking about cognitive dissonance. Cognitive dissonance is throwing out facts that are opposed to what you already believe, and it means you're not running data-driven decisions. You're basically looking for data to validate what you already know. So those critical thinking skills, that objectivity to step back, is very critical for managers and executives. And management experience is about inspiring people and growing them and coaching them, and we're going to talk more about that in a minute. So the three most critical players in any scalable business are the visionary, the operator, and the marketer. Some people only talk about two of those, the visionary and the operator, because those are the opposite ends of the spectrum. But Peter Drucker, the father of management, stated that, and I agree with it 100%, that a company only has two main jobs, innovation and marketing. Typically, the visionary is the innovator. They're looking at the future. They're understanding a problem. They're understanding the need for that solution and what people are willing to pay for it. The operator the marketing one is coming up next. Marketing and the sales leader is someone that can convey the emotion of that and the need and identify the market or generate the demand for the product with the right messaging. They're doing, CI stands for competitive intelligence, market research, and they're figuring out the product market fit. And then the operator is the person with the day-to-day management responsibility, the discipline, the detail orientation. They hire the people, they manage them, they look at the weekly, monthly, and quarterly cycles and the one-year plan for the business, while the visionary might be off thinking about 3 years down the road and another strategy. So these are the three most important people. They should be locked in long-term. They should have stock options in a scalable company to ensure they stay, and they vest the stock options only by staying there. And they should obviously be committed to the mission. Now, you can't, you know, the slavery went out the window a long time ago, right? So you can't guarantee they're going to be there, but companies use golden handcuffs to make sure that there's an alignment with the long-term needs of the company and the long-term commitment of these people. So you've got to, you cannot scale a company without having these three boxes and people checked and ideally committed. Can you turn over and have them replaced? Yes, but it's going to be very disruptive, and it's going to, you know, it's going to hurt the company, it's going to slow down the company. So ideally you want to go into this with everyone committed for a five-year plan. This is a three-way marriage where these people basically have to sign up and be a team and be committed. Now, as the company grows, the focus of what's most important will change. In the raw startup phase of a company, the innovation and the product development and the problem is what everything is about. As you move to early revenue and you have a product, clearly you're going to improve it, you're going to continue to innovate. You know, you're hopefully not going to have to pivot, but if you have to pivot, you do. But once you get to that early revenue stage, it's all about figuring out the marketing and sales. How do you do lead gen? How do you convert those leads into whatever it is that you sell, signed contracts or or online sales or anything in between, right? To become an established company, you have to have your innovation down, you have to have your marketing down, you have to have your sales process down. And at that point, you can begin to grow, but not scale. You've got to implement at that point professional management best practices, which is where most visionaries fall down, because they take their previous success in getting this far, and they let it get to their ego to think that, oh, I figured everything out before and I'm going to figure it out now. Well, I refer back to the one in 1,260 companies that is profitable, which reaches 100 million. That's a huge gap. Most entrepreneurs, and you shouldn't reinvent the wheel and try to figure that out on your own. You're hiring that expertise, you're bringing that expertise in, and that's what AirTight Management does. We infuse the best practices of professional management to take you from stage 3 to stage 4, or prepare you to go from stage 2 to stage 3 in some cases if we come in earlier as well. You cannot scale a company without having professional management best practices. The company will blow up. The company will fall apart. The brand will be ruined. There's 20 scenarios that can ruin that company, which is why only one in 6,300 companies ever reaches 100 million in sales. So first stage is innovation and vision. Second stage is sales and marketing and getting that down to a science. Third stage is implementing professional management practices. That's process optimization and improvement. You're always going to be optimizing, but you've got to document. You've got to know how to train it, not just do it. And a growth expansion, you know, is how do you take that and build out more channels of distribution, more partnerships, entering new countries and markets, licensing the core technology or product or service that you've got, and finding new ways to do it. That's very important. We'll skip over this poll real quickly because we're recording today. And here is what I call the skill set matrix. I created this back before I did the boot camp, so it must have been about 2003. And this is meant to objectively rank what a team needs to look like to be ready to grow a company at a scaling kind of level of 25%. Compound annual growth rate to 100% or more. So what you see in the left column, the strategy planning, those are skill sets that take 15 years to develop, because you have to be an individual contributor and become an expert, and then you have to become a manager, and then you have to become an executive, and only then do you probably have enough scope and view to understand strategy. Getting a Harvard MBA does not do this for you, and that's a mistake many people make and has killed a lot of companies. So these are people that you need, you know, slices of. They don't have to be full-time. They don't have to be committed. They might be on the board of directors or your board of advisors. They may be key consultants that you would bring in, but they are 15 years plus. And I see startup founders all the time who just come out of college and they want to hire their best buddy to be their CTO who just graduated college and has no experience. There is no better formula for total failure than expecting that to be successful. You are not going to get in the ring with Muhammad Ali just having graduated from high school and win a fight. And the fact that people try to do that never ceases to amaze me. They're confusing their own grit and determination, or in fact ego and self-confidence, with experience. And you're going to be up in the real world against people with experience. And if you don't have it, you're going to lose every single time. Next column is your founders, your C-level people. They need at least 10 years experience. Again, 5 years to become an expert in something, whatever they did, sales, marketing, product development. And then another 5 years to become a good manager, and ideally another 5 years to become an executive, because learning on the job is very expensive in startups that are trying to grow and scale, and you're probably going to have to hire in people over them if they don't have that level of experience. So the companies that get funded easily are the ones that have these deep teams that have done it before and can repeat that success. They're not the newbies, even though the press loves to tell these stories. Google hired, you know, people, Sergey and Brin and the other co-founder of Google did not do it all. They hired very experienced gray-haired people to come in and run the company, and they were more, you know, experts and figureheads in growing the business. But, you know, that sort of one in a million is not a strategy either. Third column is your managers. These are people with 5 to 10 years experience minimum as well. Five would be really pushing it, because, you know, they probably didn't become an expert in less than 5 years. We know, if you haven't read the book Blink by Malcolm Gladwell, read it. It talks about neuroplasticity and, you know, the process of learning and becoming an expert, the four levels of learning, of which the final level, which, you know, sometimes we've called master of a skill, is called unconscious competence. And it's when your brain has been wired with neuroplasticity to have a special processor in that brain to do that art. And you don't graduate from art school being Leonardo da Vinci. You need 5 years practice after you've learned those basics. The same is true of an MBA from Harvard. I have people come through the CEO boot camp that have PhDs and MBAs from Harvard all the time, and they ask me, why didn't they teach me this when I paid $160,000 to get my MBA? And the answer is, this is experiential learning. This comes from real practice. It's not theory. It's not in books. It's what I try to teach in my videos and inject with my consulting and coaching and mentoring work. Now, where you need the domain experience that is overemphasized in managers is here, the individual contributor, where you execute or do things. Obviously, you want to hire experts that have at least 5 years experience there. As a bigger company, you can hire rookies and train them, but you don't want to do that as a startup. You want to hire at least mid-level people with 5+ years experience. So there's 20 cells here, right? Five domains of experience or areas of the business that need to be handled, and there's 4 levels of careers. So there's about 20 skills in this that you're going to need along the way, and a good CEO is thinking about filling these in way in advance of the need. So this is the first, I think I invented this, and it's a very common slide you see in venture capital presentations nowadays, but I did one of these back in, I don't know, 1990 or 1989 or something, when I was raising money for Homeview, and this shows the experience that the team is bringing to the party. I put this here just for reference. The numbers here are sort of the minimums that I would expect that you would need to raise serious venture capital from sophisticated investors. And this is an objective way of ranking your team, and do you have what it takes in this skill set matrix. Personally, by the way, I think that another thing that is ignored that is very important is, where did they get this experience? If they're coming from IBM and a big company experience, that's not the same as startup experience. Those two are very, very different. And so you can't take a job title and assume that that person is going to be able to do that job if they came from a large company and you're going to drop into a smaller one. I was laughing my ass off, you know, back in the internet bubble when, you know, venture capitalists were hiring these big company guys and you know, funding them with $10, $20, and $30 million, and they were fish out of water because, you know, they only knew how to run a, you know, $100 million advertising budget. They didn't know how to run a startup, and, you know, so they were trying to do something that they didn't have the experience doing and go right from, you know, 0 to 100 miles an hour with the business, and that's not how companies are birthed. So growing companies is always about recruiting. I like to say that the CEO should spend 50% of their time on recruiting, mentoring, coaching, moving people up, and the learning and development plan that we'll talk about later that bonds people to the company and makes it a win-win to stay long-term. Organizational development is a continuous process, and no matter how small your company, if you want to be prepared to scale, you've got to create your internal learning and development program that captures the institutional knowledge specific to you, as well as teaches some of the generic knowledge in management and leadership and HR and, you know, all those other things that a company has to have internally. You can hire some of that expertise, but those people are going to turn over, and you've got to document in the processes that expertise as well. Number two, you should be thinking about the org chart at least a year in advance. I always have today's org chart and the org chart a year that you're building to, because it may take that long to find those people or train your existing people to move up in that responsibility. And that's a sensitive issue because, you know, everyone's sort of competing for that promotion, right? And you don't want to publish what the org chart is going to look like a year in advance necessarily, and things will change and you'll have pivots and other unknowns, but you need to know who you're developing for what future positions if you're going to be scaling. A vacuum is created in leadership and management and knowledge if you're not promoting from within and recruiting from outside the company, and that requires a plan. So you've got to have, it's not optional, you've got to have a learning and development program for managers at least, and to capture specific expertise. That depends on the business, right, and how complex the job they're doing are. But the more you're up that protectability and differentiation chart, the more you're going to need that, because the information and the training you have is different and more specific to the business, right? So if you want to keep people and the best people and attract them for the long term, research shows that 75% of employees want that learning and development program. They want challenge, they want a career path. So I don't hire people without thinking about how is their career path going to dovetail with the company's development and their position. And being a rapid growth company gives you more power because you can plan on and promote people faster. So you've got to leverage that. So a typical org chart looks like this. These are the five major areas of business. And we're going to talk more about this. You know, a scaling company is probably doing a reorganization at least once a year, and sometimes more often than that. So you've always got to have today's org chart and the one plan. So we do a scaling audit. This can be done with a half a day to a day of work, depending on the size of the company. If you'd like a scaling audit, you can use this Calendly link. Set up a private strategy session, and we'll put together a quote for you. They're fairly short and quick, and they will identify the limits in your organization that are going to prevent you from scaling more rapidly. We also have recently introduced our Platinum program, so our little promotion here in our free workshop. The Platinum program is a first in the industry to guarantee to add $10 million in valuation to a company. And we mean that seriously. We do not get 3/4 of our compensation that's expected if we do not make the metrics. So we are betting on your success. We're investing in you. And the reason we can do that is because we're going to drive up your growth rate. We're going to drive up your absolute sales, and we're going to drive up your price to earnings ratio. And if we double each of those, we will 8x the value of your company. So we usually add $10 to $30 million to a company's valuation with a one-year engagement, and the ROI of that gets better and better over time because they're going to continue to use those systems to grow at a rapid pace for a long time to come. Here's the list of topics that we'll be discussing next in session 3 and beyond up to 12. As you know, today is about team, and these are the subjects the next session. These are the first Wednesday of the month at 4 p.m. CT if you want to attend the live session. But of course, we're recording all the sessions. And if you have signed up and purchased the package, you'll have access to all the full recordings. We try to do that within a day or two. Sometimes they need a little editing and it takes a little longer, but they will certainly be available a few business days after the live session. And that way you can take notes again, redo them. We encourage people to bring their senior employees to understand these challenges because so few people have been through a rapidly scaling company. So that's it for today. And so we'll go into the Q&A and workshop session and hope to see you next time. And feel free to schedule an appointment. If you have a $1 million company and you're the CEO, we will have a free strategy session for you. And we can talk about doing an audit to find out your weakest spots that you may not be aware of that are holding your scaling efforts back. Thanks a lot for attending. I'm Bob Norton, and we'll see you in the next session. Bye-bye.